And welcome. So glad that you could be here today to Bethel Missionary Church. And our prayer is always that as we lift up Jesus Christ together, our prayer, our request is that His glory, His presence would fill not just this place, but that He would fill us. And that as we leave here, that we might leave here saying, we met with the Lord today. And so glad that you took the, made the choice to come here and gather together as the body of Jesus, the church. I really only have one announcement to pass along to you. We're speeding along through the month of April already. And of course, at the end of the month of April is the annual Maple Syrup Festival in Wakarusa. And we as a church have a part in that. We bring our little chili trailer out there and we serve Doug's chili to the community, make that available to them. And we need help with that. We always need a couple of people on hand throughout the day. The festival goes Friday, Saturday, and Sunday from 11 to 8, Friday and Saturday, and 11 to 6 on Sunday. And so we could use your help. The chili trailer is kind of the ministry of the men's group, but it's not just limited to the men's group to work it and so forth. And so if you're able to help, Dan, is there a sign-up out yet? Or okay, there's a sign-up on the Welcome Center that if you would just put your name down and let us know, and somebody will be in contact with you to get you the details. We would sure appreciate your help with that. Is there anything else that any of you have that you want to pass along that maybe I've forgotten or something that's coming up that we need to be aware of? Kind of a quiet bunch today, aren't you? Well, why don't we stand together, and we're going to share in a couple of traditional hymns, and let me invite you today to... I know sometimes, that, especially after big weekends like spring break and Easter and all that, we get kind of worn out and it just takes all that we can to get ourselves to church. Let me just challenge you to give everything that you have this morning as we worship. Maybe you're not a singer, maybe that's not your gifting, it's certainly not mine, but we're going to give everything that we have to the Lord today, and we're going to trust that as we give ourselves fully to Him, that we will experience His grace and presence today. So we're going to call each other to come and join together, okay?
Shield and defender, the ancient of days.
Father, as we gather here together, Lord, we want to give you all of our worship. And we confess, Father, that we can try our best and we can give all that we have, and we will always fall short of fully capturing how awesome and how amazing and how holy and how transcendent and how powerful you are. Lord, we want to do our best. So Holy Spirit, help us this morning as we've come here to worship in truth and spirit. Spirit, we want to invite you to come and to meet us where we're at. As I look over across this community gathered here, there's persons in all different places, different circumstances, different events and situations through this last week. And so Lord, you know where we're at. Some here have been Christian and part of a church for many, many years. And for others, they're just beginning their journey. So Lord, take us as we are. I pray that you would take us by the hand, spiritually speaking, and that you would lead us into your presence together. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're able to keep standing, we're going to share together and praise the name. And an amazing reminder of, we just celebrated Good Friday, the death of Christ on the cross, and then the resurrection on Easter. And this is a good chance for us to remind ourselves of all that Jesus has done for us. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down.
Praise his name forever. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' name.
All right, everything we got.
Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing Your praise. Oh, Lord our God. Oh, Lord our God.
I'll be reading 1 Timothy chapter 5, verses 17 through 25. Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. Do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. As for those who persist in sin, rebuke them in the presence of all, so that the rest may stand in fear. In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I charge you to keep these rules without prejudging, doing nothing from partiality. Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor take part in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. No longer drink only water, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. The sins of some people are conspicuous, going before them to judgment, but the sins of others appear later. So also good works are conspicuous, and even those that are not cannot remain hidden.
Oh, man.
may be seated. You know, I guess it's obviously something that we could have, can only imagine in our minds since we weren't there, but as Jesus was giving those final words to his followers, to his disciples there in the other upper room as they were gathered around the table, and as he spoke about leaving them soon, but he gave those reassuring words, didn't he, that don't worry, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and then I'll come back and I'll get you so that you can be with me forever. And of course, just like if we were there too, the disciples were kind of wondering, what is he talking about? And then Jesus shared with them that he is the way, the truth, and the life. And so the opportunity to sing together to remind each other of that, right? And beyond our eternal destiny, we struggle, don't we, through this life of questions of identity. Who are we? And don't let the world tell you who you are. Don't let people tell you who you are. You are who God created you to be. And in the end, that is all that will matter. Amen? Well, I was preparing kind of my list of things for us to be praying about this morning together, and I told Dwayne, happened to be up here this morning, getting some microphone things around, and I thought, man, we got so many things, and I know I'm missing a bunch, and there's always things to pray for, isn't there? And I guess that's part of living in this side of eternity, in this broken and fallen world. There's always things that we need the Lord's help with, that we have to be lifting each other up for. Let's be praying for Joey Hill. Joey's brother passed away, and the funeral for his brother was in Gary, Indiana, yesterday, so let's keep praying for Joey. Also, Sean, Aaron's son, had asked for us to be praying for his leg, and so they've done some testing, and the doctors have kind of figured out their plan for a surgery, and so Sean asked that we keep praying for him, and we're going to keep doing that, and we're going to lift him up and ask for God's grace and blessing and protection over this surgery coming up for him. We want to pray that, too, for Joe Blosser. He's been having your vein's not working like it's supposed to, and your leg, your blood flow is being restricted, so your leg goes numb, and obviously there's, if we're not careful, that could mean without enough blood flow, they could lose the leg, so they're going to fix the vein, but then in order to do that, you have to go through tests to make sure you're good for surgery. Well, they found something in the heart cath, they wanted to have him come back for deal with that, so Friday, they said they'll give you medication that should cover it for the time being, and so I know it's just been the pain issue, and then just kind of the logistics of getting here, and so we want to pray for God's grace for you as well. Lois Jean Schaefer, let's be praying for Lois Jean. She's had some health struggles here the last little while, and so let's be praying for Lois. And then Tonda and Scott Kripe are with us this morning. I mentioned Mike Kripe. You know, we've been praying for the Kripe family. Mike passed away, I guess it's been probably a couple weeks now. And so let's keep praying for God's grace and comfort for the Kripes. Is there anything else that any of you want us to be aware of so that we can be praying, so that we can make a mental note, so we can write it down, and we can keep you in mind? Well, let's pray, shall we? For someone in your family, they're close by, you can put your hand on their shoulder, and we're going to just kind of pray together that way. Lord Jesus, we need you. I don't know if we can sum it up better than the hymn writer who said, we need thee every hour. Lord, so many ups and downs, even in a given week, that we experience. So, Father, we want to take a moment. We want to lift up these names that we mentioned this morning. We want to pray for Joey. We pray for your comfort and peace for his family and their loss. Lord, we think of Tonda and Scott and Tammy and their family and this loss with Mike as well. Father, we struggle with this kind of two sides of it. On the one hand, we're thankful that a person is not suffering any longer in this side of eternity, but it changes things once we lose somebody we love. Father, I think just even in that prayer for the Selah family and the loss of a close friend who was a nurse helping with Malachi, Lord, for them, we just ask for your grace and comfort for them as well. And then we want to lift up those who are facing medical surgeries and doctor things. We think of our brother Joe. Lord, we lift him up to you, just asking for your peace, patience, protection over him. Continue to pray for Don Bollenbacher and his ongoing struggles and challenges. For Judy, I know we focus so much on Don, but I know Judy's got her own things that she deals with and carries. And so we want to lift them up to you, Father. We pray for Sean and just a protection over his leg, and that you would give wisdom to those who will be part of this medical team in the surgery. And then, Father, I want to finally just pray that as we will transition in a moment to look at the Scriptures, I pray that the ministry of the Word at Bethel Church would be effective. That it wouldn't just be a routine Bible study kind of thing that we do because that's what churches do, but Lord, that your word would be like sweet honey that nourishes us and that we crave. So I pray that you would give us ears to hear. I pray that you would give me a mouth to speak accurately, truthfully, and clearly. And then you'd help us to know what to do with it. That knowledge wouldn't just build up in our heads so that it puffs up at some point, but Lord, that knowledge would lead to transformation. I pray that our experience with the ministry of the Word wouldn't just be a Sunday morning exercise. I pray that tomorrow morning, that for my brothers and sisters here, that you would stir in them a desire and a love for your Word. I pray that you'd stir in my brothers and sisters and in me a love for prayer, that we want to spend time in conversation with you. We acknowledge as flesh and blood living in this broken world that oftentimes spiritual things aren't our natural inclination. I pray that you would put those desires there where they are not necessarily. Bind us and bond us to you, we pray. We believe that this would please you and this is what you would want for us, so we can pray in confidence in the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to be jumping back into 1 Timothy and you know, I acknowledge these passages that we've been working through here lately. It's not necessarily the kind that you want to run home and tell Ma about, probably. That's right, thank you. The Lord gave me a good wife to remind me of things. Kids, I was so excited to get going. I'd even put in my notes, dismissed for D65, and I neglected it. Maybe I would have eventually got to it. But kids, you're welcome to go downstairs. We'll go right through this front door. And, you know, just as you... as you see these kids marching past, heading on their way to their experience with God's Word, you'd be praying just blessing over them. Would you do that? Just kind of in your own heart and mind, just be praying God's blessing over them, that they would hear the not just the words of the Bible, but they would hear God's Spirit. So I believe if at a young age as kids, if they experience the presence of the living God, that it sets them up for a lifetime of faithfulness to follow him. And as we look at scripture like today, that's going to be addressing particularly what we would call elders, and maybe we could say pastors. In fact, I'll be using the term pastor today, since that's what you're most familiar with as far as church leadership, that it isn't necessarily the kind of passage you might run home and you're going to do these five things today to put it into practice, but yet I think it's something that we take God's word and we consider it and we tuck it away for when things happen in the church and in church life, and as we think about our mindset and our viewpoint of the church and how the church works, and that we always keep these things there in mind, and it helps guide us through what should be our mindset and our attitude as far as what the church looks like in leadership and so forth. And let me ask you this. When you think about something like, let me say this, the office of the president, does it bring, and you can think back as far as you want, does it bring positive things to mind or negative? Interesting, I don't know if you would agree or not, but I think I'm safe to say that there's been a degradation of the office of president over the last several decades, hasn't there? And we could probably come up with a list of agreeable reasons, maybe of character flaws or leadership styles, issues with honesty or truthfulness, etc., all those things over the years of why it is justified. But let me ask you, is it right that we would despise or degrade the office of leadership over a nation? In fact, tell me if I'm wrong, but I would say that I think there is an overall mistrust and lowering of honor and respect for leadership overall. Not just in politics, but maybe almost across the board. What do you think? So what about here in the church? Does that same mindset, that same attitude, that same viewpoint, does it spill over into how we view church leadership? Well, what then? What does God tell us in His Word? What should be our environment? What should be our kind of our culture about church leadership? As we've been working through these last few verses and sections here of 1 Timothy, Timothy now has taken some time to address the whole idea of a culture. I'm going to use the word ethos, which is this fancy Greek-based word that means kind of the culture or the environment of a community. So the kind of are the way that we function or the way that we think. So Paul is addressing that the church should be a place where there is honor and respect given to each other. And he begins chapter 5 of 1 Timothy. If you don't have a Bible, find one on your phone or find it, and there's a Bible in the seat somewhere around you there. You're welcome to open that up. You can write in it or whatever you need in order to study and to take a look at the Word with me here. But the church should be a place where there is, in our relationships with one another, honor and respect for each other. So he begins chapter 5 addressing this whole issue that in the church we should treat each other with honor and respect and with purity and dignity the way that we would treat family members, or at least the way that we should. And then he moved on and he went to address the issue of benevolence and care. And in particular in 1 Timothy here in the church of Ephesus, where Timothy is a pastor, Paul addresses the care ministry for widows. And that included, in some cases, certain cases, financially caring for and helping widows. And now he's going to address the relationship of the church as it has to do with leadership. And so here in verse 17, he begins, he says, "Let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor." He uses the word for elder, which is earlier used for an older man, but before we say, well, he's talking to the older men, this word for elder is interchanged in the New Testament and even in Paul's writing elsewhere for overseer, who is a term for a church leader, like from chapter 3. And as you'll begin to see this passage unfold, you'll see that most likely Paul is speaking to church leadership or overseers. We use the term pastor based on a Latin word. And so he's going to be speaking specifically about the leadership role in the church, especially of those whose primary role is what we would call the ministry of the word. I use that term, ministry of the word, referring to the ministry of preaching and teaching. And here's the overall big idea I want you to take hold of today. In the church, there should be an attitude of honor and respect, of course, right? And there should be, and with that, there should, of course, be honor and respect for the preacher. So, Peter, by the way, I want to just take a moment to publicly give thanks for Peter Bollenbacher. I don't know if you guys see Peter much. He's always stowed away up in the crow's nest there. It's not an easy role to be the PowerPoint guy. Because you do all this work of preparing the PowerPoints and advancing it, but people only notice when you don't get it, right? And so you be sure to thank those. I know that Dwayne and Derek Hernandez and those that work in the sound and some of the less noticeable ministries, and I praise God for their work. And so let's be a thankful church, a way that we can show honor and dignity to each other, right? So anyways, in the church there is to be honor for the preacher, for the pastor. And I'm not just making this up. I'm not telling you this because I am one. This is what God's word says. This is where verse 17, let the elders who rule well be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who labor in preaching and teaching. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain, and the laborer deserves his wages. So the first thing is this. It's interesting that verse 17, and if you look up to verse 9, you'll see it too. And if you look over to chapter 6, verse 1, there's this word, at least in the ESV, let. Let a widow be enrolled. Let the elders who rule be considered worthy. Let all who are under a yoke as bondservants regard. Interestingly, Paul chooses to use a verb form that is, it's an imperative, it's a command, it's an instruction, right? An imperative means do this, but yet he uses what we call the middle voice, which is kind of more of a passive way of saying it. So it's almost like this balance between do this, an instruction, a command, and a permission or allowance. And I wonder if it's because Paul is addressing this whole idea of an ethos or an environment of a church, that these things are to happen. Timothy, make sure as the leader in this church that these things are happening in the church. But the hope is it becomes kind of just a mindset and a culture in a local church that these things should happen. And you, by all means, allow it to happen. Let it happen. So let the elders who rule be considered worthy of double honor. So he addresses those who have taken the lead well. He says those who have ruled well. And then specifically he says especially or in particular, where melista, most of all, he's used that word earlier in verse 8, to kind of set apart a particular group, especially those who work or who labor in preaching and teaching. Here's the point I want you to write down if you're keeping notes. The church honors the pastor by giving respect and compensation for the ministry of the word. By the way, I feel a little weird talking about these things, being the guy that on the receiving end of those, right? But beyond Joel Gentz, is this not what God's word is telling us? So it shouldn't just be a Bethel thing. It shouldn't just be a Joel Gentz thing. It should be a churches everywhere thing. Paul's used this word honor a couple of times now. But he uses it in some different ways. Sometimes it might mean like honor, like we would think of honor meaning respect, right? But then, as you saw earlier, if you were with us, and addressing the issue with widows, you begin to pick up, I think he's talking more about than just being respectful to the widows. I think he's talking about helping financially the widows. So, in particular, for those whose work is the ministry of the word, what does he say? Those who rule well should be considered worthy of what? Double honor. I like that verse. I think I'm going to make that my life verse. I'm going to write that down somewhere here. I don't know. I guess in its just basic form, it could mean like, pay him double. I guess the question is double from what? If someone's getting paid zero, well, we can double zero. That's easy, right? Some would say, well, it must mean just like, you know, pay him double or something. But like I said, well, that's kind of hard. But perhaps it's a little bit more to it. Maybe it's just Paul's way of emphasizing an attitude of generosity, to give generously. And certainly elsewhere, as Paul talks about the church giving and helping with needs, and that we should, the Lord loves a cheerful giver, right? The Lord loves generosity. But it could also just be the idea of double meaning. On the one side, respect and honor in that way, and on the other side, compensation. And I'm kind of taking it to mean that. And let me just say this. I know that different churches, depending on the size, depending on the community and the economic situation where persons are, some churches are not able to afford to pay a pastor at least full time. But I just want to take a moment to speak to Bethel Church. I want you to know that Bethel Church is a very generous church for a church our size. Did you know that? And when it comes to paying the pastor and taking care of the pastor's family, you have been a very benevolent and generous church. I'm not saying that so that you could say, well, we should do less then. Because there used to be, and maybe it still is in some places, in some churches, there was a mindset that the pastor should be poor. Any of you ever heard that kind of mindset before? We've got to make sure they're kind of just, we don't want to get too haughty or something. But that's not what the scriptures say, does it? And in fact, to have that mindset would go against what Paul's teaching here, isn't it? That the church should be generous in the way that they take care of leaders, especially those who labor, he says, in preaching and teaching. Literally, he says, in logos or logo, which is the word we use for word, probably meaning public proclamation, so we might say preaching, and teaching. Obviously, there's carryover with the two of them, but sometimes there's distinctions between preaching. Especially, I think, in the way that the New Testament uses preaching, it has a lot to do with the proclamation of the gospel in particular, Jesus crucified and raised again. Teaching is, of course, teaching doctrine and theology. I don't know if you know this or not, but to teach accurately and thoroughly takes time for study and preparation. And if someone is going to teach much or teach thoroughly, it obviously, like anything, it just takes time. And so I wonder if Paul is saying specifically to those who labor in the ministry of the word, because if one's out evangelizing and preaching and they're teaching, it takes time. And in order for one to dedicate their time and efforts into that ministry, it makes that available when the church is generous to give not just honor and respect, but also compensation for the ministry of the word. Now, could this just be specific to Ephesus? Could this just be specific to Timothy's issue in somewhere around 60 AD when this letter was written? Well, it's not that simple, because look what he does in verse 18, the same thing that he had done in chapter 2 in addressing the issue of roles, gender roles in ministry, is he links his current application to a deeper general scriptural principle based on God's creative order from the Word. So what does he say? For the Scripture says. Isn't that a powerful phrase? How many of you get tired of hearing, I think, it's my opinion, the Scripture says. The Scripture says, and then he quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 4, you shall not muzzle an ox when it treads out the grain. Maybe you're scratching your head, okay, so how do we get from paying the pastor to an ox treading out grain? Well, if you picture harvesting, they didn't have combines in the first century, so what they would do is they'd harvest the whole wheat plant, let's say, or grain, and they'd throw it down in this big kind of patio-type area on the ground, hard-packed ground with some little bit of a curb around it or a wall around it, and they would put an ox inside of that place, and the ox would either walk or would drag some kind of sled thing over top of this grain going in circles, and it would tread out the grain, obviously, when you're grinding it down. So what is Paul saying? Well, if the ox is doing the work, shouldn't he or she have the right to put down her mouth once in a while and take a bite? How cruel is it to say, you're doing the work here, but you can't partake in any of the reward for it, any of the harvest for it. Interesting, in Deuteronomy, it's an odd context where that verse comes up. He's speaking of corporal punishment, public floggings, and all of a sudden there's this passage, you shall not muzzle an ox while it's treading out the grain. The principle being this, it's not right to deprive someone or something of sharing in the harvest, so to speak, for his or her work. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul addressing another church, talking about a similar issue having to do with the right of the apostles and being paid for their work, specific to him. Speaks of the plowman as well as the thresher. All of those involved in the whole process of preparing, tilling soil, and all the way up to harvest, that if anyone's involved in the labor, should they not be able to partake in the fruit of it? You think about one of the great cruelties of slavery is that whole mindset of you got to do all the work in this, but you don't get to partake in any of the reward or fruit of it. And so Paul is laying out a principle here to establish that this isn't just something for Ephesus, it's not just something in Paul's mind, but this is something that God intends. And it also carries over into spiritual matters as well in the work of the church. And then, he says, not just about the ox, but then what? The laborer deserves his wages. Well, where in the Old Testament is that? Well, you won't find it in there. Well, where did Paul, what scripture did he get this from? Do you know? This very phrase came from the very lips and mouth of Jesus. In Luke chapter 10, verse 7, Luke is sending out his disciples, and they're going to be doing the ministry of the work, and he tells them that they as they're out there, that they will be cared for, because that comes with it, because the laborer deserves his wages. Something similar again in 1 Corinthians 9, he alludes to something that Jesus said, or this idea of what Jesus said, which, just as a note, it demonstrates that even by the time of Paul's writing, that the early church equated and rose to level the words of Jesus with that of Scripture. And so Paul's saying, it's not just an Old Testament thing, the Scripture says, Jesus, our Lord, says as well. And so he carried over this idea from the Old Testament, and the teachings of Jesus were also carried over to the level of authority of Scripture as well. So then, verse 19, it kind of changes gears a little bit. Do not admit a charge against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. Here's a second thing. So first of all, the scripture is clear that the church should be, you know, assuming that the ability is there, that they should be willing to compensate their pastor or their leader, elder. But the second thing is the church honors the pastor by giving him the benefit of the doubt unless evidence warrants otherwise. How do you feel about that one? Is that not kind of what Paul is saying here? Do not entertain or don't accept or don't admit a charge or an allegation against an elder except on the evidence of two or three witnesses. He references this idea of two or three witnesses. This is a theme that goes throughout Scripture based on the Old Testament law. And let me just read from Deuteronomy chapter 19. This is what it says. You must not convict anyone of a crime. Now, by the way, the Old Testament law was establishing the law of the land of a nation. So this wasn't just something for the Christian community or the Jewish community within their own church and synagogue. This is for the law of the land. You must not convict anyone of a crime on the testimony of only one witness. The facts of the case must be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If a malicious witness comes forward and accuses someone of a crime, then both the accuser and the accused must appear before the Lord by coming to the priest and judges in office at that time. The judges must investigate the case thoroughly. If the accuser has brought false charges against his fellow Israelite, you must impose on the accuser the sentence he intended for the other person. In this way, you will, look at this, in this way you will purge such evil from among you. Then the rest of the people will hear about it and be afraid to do such an evil thing. Kind of a way to keep everybody a little honest, right? Because people say all kinds of things for all kinds of reasons, right? Again, let me just say this. There's no perfect church, obviously. Some are better places to be than others. And Bethel has been a great place for us. And so I just want to commend you in that. But I want you to know this, and I can list names for you of others in ministry, of brothers in the ministry, who haven't had a great situation. Because the pastor is subject to much criticism, complaint, and accusations. It's important that sin be dealt with, and we're going to talk about that in just a moment. But the accusations of sin be demonstrated with thoroughness. Does that make sense? In fact, if we were to step outside of the church of Ephesus and Timothy, if we were to step outside of even the church and just consider a broader teaching moment in general, I think that God knew what he was doing, what he established here in Deuteronomy. In fact, I would say that it's based on this concept that in our own nation, as our nation was founding its own law, that certainly in the back of their mind there was this concept. And so we have the concept in our judicial system of innocent until proven guilty. Have you heard that before? I have a fear that we're moving towards public opinion and media coverage, which tends to make judgments and decisions, oftentimes just based on accusations, are almost sufficient for conviction. Even in what might be terrible or heinous circumstances like murder or sexual assault, it's important for us to keep this concept in mind, I think, as a society and as a culture. In fact, as you know, as a nation, we've been the killing of George Floyd is on trial right now, isn't it? How many of you have at least saw something about that and been following? There have been celebrities and people in public ways that have suggested that we don't need a trial to convict. As heinous and as terrible as the circumstance, I think we want to be careful about that kind of precedent. It's easier when we're on the side of the judge and jury than on the side of the one who is on trial. Of course, I tell you this as a, I think, for something for us to consider and to be careful about, to be sure that we know the evidence and the facts as a cultural value. But my fear is that sometimes those cultural values and things that are happening outside of the church and in the general society begins to creep its way and becomes a value and a viewpoint that can be brought into the church as well. And we want Bethel Church to be a place of honesty and dignity and respect, but also a place where discipline and consequences are instituted based on facts and evidence, not just solely on allegations and accusations. And the role and office of a pastor or elder in the church is an important and God-ordained role. I find it interesting that the way that God works, and I don't understand God fully, do you? Maybe you could help me. Because God elevates a certain aspect. Like in the church, there is the priesthood of all believers, that we are not like a Levitical priesthood like in the Old Testament where there's a priest who represents God to you and you're here and the priest is here and God's here. That all of us have access through Jesus Christ into the throne room, right? Through prayer. But don't ever assume that God is not picky about roles and authority and so forth and structure. For example, God makes a big deal about children obeying their parents, honoring their parents. Did you know that? Nowhere does he say in that context, does he, that if your parents are cool, if you like them, if they deserve it, does he? Sometimes, no matter necessarily the person who's in there, in that role, God expects a certain respect and honor for the role itself. And in this case, as God has spoken to Paul, or through Paul to Timothy, to the church of Ephesus, it carries on to us by principle that there should be a sense of honor, and with honor that means there's a mindset of respect that gives the benefit of the doubt unless or until evidence suggests otherwise. And the great news is this. If we put into practice chapter 3, take a glance back at chapter 3, that had to do with the qualifications of those who should be leaders in the church, it will help us by going a long way to do preventative work, right? But unfortunately, because even pastors are flesh and blood, pastors can fall into sin. That happens, obviously. And so I'm going to switch gears just a little bit. We've talked about the pastor. We're kind of talking about the person in that role. Let's talk about the role itself a little bit. Do not admit a charge against an elder except in the evidence of two or three witnesses. Verse 20, as for those who persist in sin, this is talking about elders, pastors, there's plenty of evidence. There's more than one person. There's a couple people that say what's happening is a problem. This is wrong. As for those who persist or continue in sin, rebuke them That means to expose or to express strong disapproval, bringing something to light. I would say clearly articulating what is wrong, what is the problem, what is the sin. Rebuke them in the presence of all so that the rest may stand in fear. Does that sound familiar from Deuteronomy chapter 19? Well, in fact, it's also repeated in Deuteronomy chapter 13, this idea of public discipline, public consequences for sin has a tendency to kind of put the fear of God in people. And in particular, when sin continues and there's a persistence and it's publicly addressed, it also speaks volumes to the other leaders in the church, right? So all probably meaning everybody, and rest meaning the other elders. So the third point is this. The church honors the pastorate, or I'm going to say, we could say the office of the pastor, by publicly disciplining pastors persisting in sin. So if we're tracking along, these two or three witnesses verify the misconduct or abuse of the office and the role. It's established that sin is happening, so how do we as a church deal with it? Well, Paul probably has something in mind, again, the words of Jesus, maybe something like Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18 sets out a process of what we might call church discipline. When somebody is, their life is inconsistent with the truth of God's word, there's a process to deal with that. I can tell you what the tendency to do is with those situations is to talk to anybody but the person typically. But that's not the way that Matthew 18 lays it out. He begins, Jesus says that you're supposed to personally address this sin issue with the person. With the hope, obviously, that they would say, you're right. And work on it. But sometimes people don't own up to it, right? So then Jesus says to take along what? Two or three witnesses. Others who can verify, yes, we see this too. This is not right. Again, with the hope of now bringing a couple more people into the circle that someone would be willing to come to repentance and confession and to make it right. Sometimes they don't. Then Jesus says to take it publicly before the church. Let me say this, with the hope of restoration is the point. Galatians 6 says, dear brothers and sisters, if another believer is overcome by sin, you who are godly should gently and humbly, look at those words, help that person back onto the right path and be careful not to fall into the same temptation yourself. And hopefully, when, as Paul says, it's brought before all, it has a tendency to bring about change and transformation, good things. Restoration is the hope. But Jesus says in Matthew 18, at that point, if someone refuses to listen and to take ownership of their sin, then that person is more or less to be removed from the fellowship then. In Deuteronomy, this idea of public addressing sin publicly, one of the context of verse 13 is about public execution for apostasy. And in the church, we're not going to publicly execute the pastor, thank the Lord. But when there is unconfessed or persistent ongoing sin, it must be addressed publicly. And I kind of wondered why. Well, maybe because the role of a pastor and the ministry of the pastor is public. And the purity of that ministry and that role is important, isn't it? And so when sin happens, we have to deal with it. But believe me, church discipline is really, really hard in the church. And we don't look forward to it at any level. Church discipline isn't necessarily just for pastors. We're talking about it here in this context, but it goes beyond that as well. And we don't take that lightly. You be praying for your church leaders. You pray, be praying for your pastor. It would be a lot easier if we don't have to go through that stuff, wouldn't it? Verse 21, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus and of the elect angels, I charge you to keep the rules without prejudging, that is to make a judgment before the trial, doing nothing from partiality. So Paul's given Timothy a reminder that we want to be careful in this whole process of not showing partiality or making judgments before the time of trial. We briefly talked about that before, but because of this work of discernment and discipline in the church is with the backdrop behind us of the heavenly court and the bench of judges, right? God, Jesus Christ, and the elect or specific angels who have a role in the judgment. But the good news is, and this is the last thing, and this is important for us, this will maybe help us to avoid some of these other issues. The last point, the church honors the pastorate or the office of the pastor by being cautious and patient when promoting men into it. So verse 22, do not be hasty in the laying on of hands, nor take part in the sins of others. Keep yourself pure. Then there's this really weird verse, verse 23. Look at it. No longer drink only water, but use a little wine for the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. Anyways, back onto our conversation. The sins of some people are conspicuous, going before them to judgment, but the sins of others appear later. So also good works are conspicuous, and even those that are not remain hidden. Well, we'll talk about the wine in a second here, okay? Let's finish up. The last thing is this. The church honors the pastorate or the office of the pastor by being cautious and patient when promoting men into it. The best outcome or the best road to success is usually done by good preventative work, right? Paul speaks in two directions, negatively and positively. Well, what do we mean? Well, this, in many cases, if we go back to chapter 3 and we consider who should be our leaders and who should be qualified for a pastor, many characteristics and life choices are evident and sufficient to say no to somebody. At this point, no, you're not qualified for this and this reason. Right? What did he say? Do not be hasty in the laying on of hands. Now, in the New Testament, anytime that concept of laying on hands happens, it usually means that people are being set aside or ordained for some kind of leadership ministry. Maybe to go out on the mission field, maybe to, like for Timothy, to lead this church. It's kind of their way of commissioning or giving the approval for someone for leadership. And so the best thing is to not be hasty or too quick to do that, but be careful and discerning. In fact, in chapter 3, verse 4, it said, he must manage his own household well with all dignity, keeping his children submissive. For someone who does not know how to manage his own household, how will he care for God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may become puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Now, I don't want to go back and re-preach that. But all that to say, those things are only discerned and noticeable over time, right? So as a church, we would be doing ourselves and our pastor best by being just cautious and patient when promoting people into leadership, especially in this capacity. Lest you, Timothy, also be enabling and perpetuating sin. So Paul says, nor take part in the sins of others, keep yourself pure. If there are persons that have character flaws and sin issues that are being pushed into leadership, are we not enabling or encouraging or condoning that? So we want to be careful and discerning in this process. Now, you're wanting to know about the wine, aren't you? Well, probably what's happened, and I don't know, here's something about Paul. Paul is very complex in his writing and stuff, right? If you've ever, in fact, Peter even says that Paul's hard to understand sometimes. Anybody agree? Paul likes run-on sentences, okay? Are any of you like this? You are in a conversation and then you wonder, why? How did we get on this topic when you're talking? Because one thing reminds you of something else and then you're over here and then you're like, oh yeah, we got to go back to this, right? Well, Paul likes to do that. So he'll get going on something and all of a sudden he's really throwing some stuff in there and then he comes back to what he was talking about before. Well, evidently something was triggered in Paul's mind about Timothy's personal situation. More than likely, what's happened is the big issue is a problem with leadership in the church of Ephesus. There are teachers who were there teaching false teachings, and they were taking advantage of people. They were being sexually immoral. They were taking people's money, and they were drinking too much and all of those things. And these people are in leadership in this church, and Paul's sending Timothy in there to set it straight. Well, probably in Timothy's great concern for the community of Ephesus, for the church of Ephesus, Ephesus Missionary Church, Timothy's concerned. He goes in there, and he was seeking to be set apart and to be different from these other leaders who were self-indulgent womanizers and drunks. So probably what Timothy did was, they like the strong drink, so I'm going to abstain completely from it. Which you can commend Timothy, and that shows a lot about his heart, doesn't it? But his choice to do so was also taking a physical toll on him. In the ancient world, wine was a way of medicinally treating some certain ailments. So we don't know what Timothy's problems were. Something to do with his stomach and other issues. What did Paul say? For the sake of your stomach and your frequent ailments. Any of you have frequent ailments? You're in good company. So as he's talking about this purity and keeping himself pure, maybe that was one of those areas where Timothy was really trying to be different. And Paul's saying, what does he say? Does he say, don't drink water? No. No longer drink only water, but use how much wine? A little bit. Paul is giving his brother more of a medicinal treatment plan, not like you use drink, man, you start drinking. Okay, so I think we want to be mindful of that. A little wine. But I think, you know, I didn't make a specific point about this. But maybe as a side note, there's an emphasis on the importance of also being mindful for the leadership of the church for what we might call self-care, lest one burn out or run oneself to death, which can happen. Because ministry is different than a lot of other things. I'm not saying that to lessen or undermine other work. It's just the pastorate's, it's weird. In fact, our taxes are weird too, the way that we file taxes. Everything about being a pastor is just different. The pastor I worked with used to say that, well, I get paid to eat and talk. Some days it's like that. You go out for a breakfast appointment with somebody and you drink coffee and eat a breakfast and you talk with them and pray with them. Sometimes the ministry can be emotionally draining and demanding. And just this idea, I think that we got to be careful too of what you might call self-care. I think Paul's speaking to Timothy about that. Timothy, I appreciate your mind. I appreciate your attitude. But you know what? You got to take care of that stomach issue at some point a little bit. So the church should be a place where there is a sense of honor for the preacher. We talked through what that means according to what Paul says here in the Word. There was an article from 2019. In fact, I'd probably say that things are probably worse than they were in 2019 from Religion News. And it begins talking about in 2004, there was a Pulitzer Prize-winning novel called Gilead. And Marilyn Robinson, the writer, sketches a portrait of the Reverend John Ames, a small-town pastor in the 1950s in Iowa, who was humble, self-aware, compassionate, and devoted to his family and his congregation, and they to him. And the article goes on to say that Americans no longer hold clergy in such high regard, according to a recent poll. And even regular churchgoers are seeking counsel elsewhere. It said that there was a poll taken that shows that doctors, teachers, members of the military, even scientists are viewed more positively than clergy. The less frequently people attend church, the more negative their views. Among those who attend less than once a month, it says that only 42% said they had a positive view of clergy members, a rate comparable to that of lawyers, who rank near the bottom of the list of professions. The article goes on then to try to maybe figure out what's led to this, and maybe stemming back to a mistrust, as I began my message this morning, a mistrust in general leadership, maybe from the 1970s with having to do with a dishonesty from Washington in regards to maybe the Vietnam War, and then add to that the many scandals in the Catholic Church or even in the evangelical church that seems to be always happening, right? Or televangelists, that maybe has contributed to the current viewpoint. But here's one of the summaries from the survey. It said Americans across the board said they did not want clergy input when it came to family planning, child rearing, sex, careers, financial decision making, medical decision making, or voting. Clergy, the poll suggests, are growing irrelevant. What do you think? What is that stemming from? Lord, help us. Because if it is the ministry of the Word which reveals to us what is God's truth, as it relates to all those things listed, family planning, child rearing, sex, careers, financial decision making, medical decision making, voting, all of those things, if God's Word speaks into those matters, and furthermore, the proclamation of the gospel reveals the way of salvation, then we need to have good leadership in the church, don't we? And I'm not sure the best way to end such a conversation about our dilemma that we have here and now. But we can approach the one who does know all things in prayer, can't we? Is the solution that the congregation just needs to trust more? Or do leaders just need to be more trustworthy? Well, we can't fix every church and every problem, can we? But we can work on things here in our own community, Bethel Church. So I'm going to be asking you, you be praying for me as your leader. I know you do. Do so even more, how about? That I would lead well, that I would fulfill the call to the ministry of the Word with faithfulness. You pray that the Lord would protect me from evil, that I would be aware to be able to see the schemes and the works of the evil one, lest I fall into temptation. And we'll be praying, too, for our church family, that We will continue to be a church who has a great, healthy respect for leadership. And when there are problems, that we're not afraid to deal with it. Boy, isn't that oftentimes a tendency. If you're anything like me, I don't get excited about confrontation. Sometimes it's easier just to ignore things, right? Let's pray, shall we? Lord, it's a little weird, as I said, talking about my own job and my own role here, but this is your word, and the ministry of the word means we cover all of it whenever it talks about anything. So the pastor at Bethel Church, it can't just be theoretical about pastors. We can't just have this rubric and template about pastoral ministry, because it's real life and it's real people and relationships. So help us to be faithful, to put into practice, to put into doing the word. Lord, I confess that even for me, when I think about leadership, sometimes I just get kind of a sour feeling because of all the things that we see where there is abuse and misuse. And but we don't want to be just bitter, resentful, disrespectful, anarchist-type mindset people, or to respect and to honor those roles that you've established. I pray that you would help us to use great discernment through the work of the Holy Spirit when we put people into those places of leadership, knowing that they're not perfect. Mistakes are made, and hopefully we own up to them, and we work on them, and we own up to it. I pray receptive so that, Lord, we don't have to put into practice something, a big deal like church discipline. So help us to be a church with a good ethos and mindset about honor and respect, good boundaries, and we want to pray for your blessing and protection over the ministry here, so that the ministry of the word, the proclamation of Jesus crucified and raised again, would be without blemish, without tarnish, based on our failure. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to close this morning with a good old traditional American hymn. We started this morning with a Spanish traditional melody, and Come Christians Join to Sing. And we're going to close out with How Firm a Foundation. I'm just going to give you a little heads up that the hymn, they go by fast. There's plenty of verses, but they'll go really fast. And I thought about cutting some out, but they were all so good, I couldn't decide which ones. So I said, we're going to do them all. But let's stand together if you're able. And I want you just, as the words are flying by, you just be thinking about what we're singing. And may it be a prayer for us.